Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We are about to start the startup session. May I request all the panelists to be on the dais, please? Our panelists on the dais, please. And also, we have an anchor from Times, Ms. Smithy Grover. Ladies and gentlemen, kindly give a big hand of applause to our young startups of India. Mr. Prashant Tandon, the CEO and founder of 1MG. We have with us Mr. Adhil, the CEO and co-founder of bankbazaar.com. And we have Amit Chaudhry, the co-founder of Lenskart. Before I hand over to our anchor, I'd like to inform the audience that the FICCI great work in this innovation and startup had been for the last 11 years. We operate 29 projects with various governments, with various, not only the Indian government, we have partnered with US government, the UK government, the Rwanda government, the Ethiopian government, the ASEAN India Innovation Platform. We have a fund of $50 million, which is the most popular fund in social impact called Millennium Alliance, and you must be aware about that. And we are proud to have partners like MIT Boston, University of Texas, CMU, Stanford Business School, and I am Ahmedabad, I am Bangalore, and ISB Hyderabad. We are very thankful, and we have, since 2006, FICCI has supported more than 1,300 startups, handhold them, and awarded through our various program. Our two startups are on all listed stock exchange. We have generated over $2 billion economic impact and created 200,000 jobs impacting 7 million lives. Madam, I'd like to request my founder to take over and anchor the session. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much for that introduction. And, you know, we at Times Network, especially at Times Now and ET Now, really believe that innovation is the backbone of a nation's progress. And it can really bring in transformational change that can impact and help, I think, millions of lives. And I believe that, you know, that's a vision that today's aspiring entrepreneurs also have to make that change, to make that impact. And, you know, have a vision of business models that are not only generating revenues, but generating employment, generating opportunities, and benefiting one and all. And obviously, I have an esteemed panel who are veterans when we talk about entrepreneurship and startups, and are here to share their views and their insights on, you know, the experiences that they've gone through and the challenges that young Turks of today face. So, you know, let me begin by you, Adhil. And why I'm asking you this is because, you know, the government has this immense push on digital being first now, and the whole financial inclusion model that the government really wants to push through in this sector. What are the kind of opportunities that startups have today, especially in the financial sector? And do you see that, you know, there are things that have changed when it comes to ability of starting your own business now?
Great question. I can speak from the perspective of financial services, and that's where BankBazaar operates. We have a marketplace which has about 370 lakh visitors every month who come looking for access to financial products. These could be loans, these could be small insurance products, mutual fund products. I think the real opportunity in fintech is that in a country as large as India, wherein there are so many operational difficulties, the mobile phone becomes a great way for us to leapfrog many Western markets and deliver financial products to the entire population. So today, everyone is so comfortable with chatting online, with using their online system to book various things, that it becomes very natural, right, that rather than having to set up a branch in every village, if we can just turn the mobile phone into a platform where financial products can be delivered instantly. I think there are two opportunities coming up in digital India. So one is from the consumer side. So you talk to any young person, and for them, the most natural process when they want something, be it food, be it entertainment, be it to book travel, automatically the mobile phone comes out. And the same thing is happening for finance. They want a bank account, the mobile phone comes out. And I think the good thing the government of India has done is essentially pushed the India stack. Now, the India stack is a great infrastructure based on which we can digitally sign documents, based on which we can prove identity online, pretty much avoiding all of the old paper-based processes. I think the government has really become open to startups. They call us in, they ask us what kind of regulatory support do you need, what kind of policy-making support you need, and that is brilliant. I think that startups have a voice today, and like you said earlier, we're creating jobs, we're creating financial inclusion in India.
So, you know, I'm going to come to the government policies and what can be done on that regards. But Prashant, what has really improved in terms of someone who really wants to start up today and start his own business vis-a-vis, let's say, you guys, when you guys started maybe way back in the early 2000s?
So I think, I think the ecosystem has matured significantly, and what that has resulted in is, because a lot of things are required to make a startup ecosystem. Now, the social acceptance of startups has gone up significantly. So a person taking a plunge, now it's almost glamorous to be in this space. So that I think is very, very important. Secondly, it's also the financial opportunity or availability, which is a lot of people are now very keen to participate as angel investors in startups. And that's very important. Earlier, all investments would go in some other financial products or real estate or gold or things like that. Now people actually enjoy saying that I am also a part of these few startups. What that has meant, a lot of capital availability at the basic level has improved. And I think the other very important thing that has happened in the ecosystem is also that now people are seeing role models come up. So sure. Businesses have started maturing. They have people to look up to. All of that is a natural phase of growth of a maturing ecosystem. Around the time when we started, that was, I would say, in the early stages of evolution. Now it's kind of front and center. So
you know, you're saying that it's sort of also cool now to invest in a startup rather than investing in your normal sort of routine investments that you would make in gold or in an infrastructure project, etc. But do you think even on the entrepreneur side, that whole mindset of ready to take risk and ready to, you know, go away with that fixed income and plunging into entrepreneurship also really set in?
Certainly. I think people are feeling a lot more encouraged. What was stopping people earlier? It wasn't that there were not problems to be solved. It was just that there were too many fears dissuading the actual leap from happening. Those fears have gone up. It has become the cool thing to do. That itself drives a lot of youngsters that let's do something cool. There is the family support or the parents, how they think about a child going into the startup world or the uncertainty it represents. How employers look at people with startup experience. Earlier, it was the thing was a person who tried and failed would carry a stigma. Now that's a badge of honor. You try, you are an entrepreneur and you learned so much in 2 years that you would not probably have learned in any job. And now you are a much more refined asset for any other company. So I think all of that, if you'll just look at our example, at least 10, 12 of our core folks have tried their hand at entrepreneurship. Obviously, 90%, 95% of ventures do not work, but it does not mean disaster. It means you are actually better positioned to get a role in the companies that are then working.
Or better experience to start
something. It's a great school. You learn quite a lot.
Amit, I'm really intrigued with Lenskart's story because, you know, I never thought that this model would really pick up that well. and someone would go and buy eyewear online and then maybe check it out on a retail store as well. So what really works in a startup business? Is it innovation? Is it filling that gap, you know, that was not addressed? Or is it perhaps looking at global solutions and fitting them locally that would actually make you tick?
First of all, thanks for having me here. And I'll take some cues from Prashant's point. And, you know, and to answer your question, the first point would be the team. When we look back, when we started 8 years back, and it is just not the founders, like we are three founders, it's just not the founders. But there are a lot other people, like at least 20, 30 of them who took that plunge of staying there, you know, and trying to be part of that, you call it innovation, you call it strategy, but being part of that struggle. You know, today we can celebrate where we have reached, but there was a time, as you mentioned, that you didn't think that it will succeed. Even we didn't think it will succeed, right? But as founders, you cannot show that face, but the team can always motivate you and put you that we have to still try. And I'll say innovation and strategy is more about perseverance, and your team has a key role to play there.
But Adhil, something like finance or you know, something technical, then technology comes in and plays a very important role, because I think where we're talking about security, technology perhaps can solve a lot more issues than a human interface. How do you see technology disruption in your model that you're kind of putting forth as a key enabler to make that startup really work and tick?
Yeah, so see, technology is key to the very heart of what we do at BankBazaar. So we're saying that there was an old way to deliver financial products which involved meeting, which involved collecting your income documents, collecting your driver's license, and so on and so forth. Today, what has happened, right, is that there's a very powerful ecosystem available in India of tech systems which can allow you to do everything you need for financial services on the mobile phone. So whether it is to be able to authenticate identity, whether it is to be able to authenticate income, whether it is to be able to take a decision saying, do I want to give this product or not, and communicate to the customer what this product means, everything is there in your mobile phone today. So what startups are doing, right, is putting 100% of our resources into this space of building high-end technology, but also collaborating with the incumbents. So what we believe is this is a big market out there. If we can create a trusted brand that consumers come to on BankBazaar, and we can provide a system in which they can access any financial product in 5 minutes, then why would they not come? But the products themselves, right, is in close partnership with all of the financial institutions. So I think this is a win-win. You know, we're helping existing financial institutions sell their products on the mobile phone in collaboration with us, and we're servicing a new generation of consumers who magically, right, is now choosing to shop online.
So when you have so much technological interface, then does the regulatory framework become a barrier sometimes?
The regulatory framework is very important, because what happens is technology typically stays ahead of the regulatory framework. So today, right, I'm required to come to your house and pick up certain identity docs and certain income docs. Now, what we push for, right, is can we enable policy that allows us to use the technology we've already built? So a key example is India Stack. Now, the India Stack allows you to authenticate identity. It allows you to sign contracts. It allows you to establish that you work where you say you do. Can the regulatory policymakers allow us to do and make use of these technologies? For example, one big discussion we're having right now is, why should I meet you to authenticate that you are who you say you are? Can I use video? And can I use artificial intelligence on the video to authenticate that you are who you say you are and you can get the product? So at the end of the day, right, policy making and technology have to be very closely associated, because otherwise the technology can be there, but unless the regulation allows for it, we become handicapped.
So Prashant, everyone's really talked about the government push, you know, towards boosting the startup economy and entrepreneurship. But what does the government really need to prioritize, you know, to create that enabling environment for startups? I'm sure there are a million things that they're doing right, but there are a million others that they can really focus on.
Yeah, so I think, first of all, I have to acknowledge that actually the government is listening, and that itself is very encouraging. Government bodies like Startup India actually help and handhold in a lot of issues that are brought up to their attention. But I think what needs to be done, or at least the way I see it, is the government is organized in a certain way, and there needs to be almost a very new thought on the structure, because I'll come from my part of the industry now. For any issue that is required, there are always 3, 4, 5 different ministries involved. When now the solutions are becoming much more inter-ministry or much more pervasive, because our industries are not as vertical as traditional industries were. It's not healthcare is one industry, IT is another industry, and agriculture, finance, whatever would be different. So different capabilities are required to deal with a situation like this, and the government is really not organized to deal with that thing. So, because, for example, whether it is technology or AI in healthcare, it would require Ministry of IT participation, Ministry of Commerce participation, Ministry of Healthcare participation, and that it needs to be much more, I would say, concentrated or integrated than we find it as of now. So I think that is one change that we'll certainly hope to see. The other thing, just one little thing, in regulated sectors, by definition, the job of the regulator is to maintain status quo, and the job of an innovator is to break status quo. So there is a natural conflict which always will be there.
Which is very healthy, I think.
Which needs to be very healthy,
yeah.
And that's the challenge. How to make it in a manner that it doesn't stifle innovation while keeping the requirements of the regulator in place. More than anything, it requires people to talk a lot more actively. And for innovators and startups, time-bound, quick response is what is, I think, fundamentally the most important thing.
Amit, when we're talking here about this vast opportunity that is unfolding in front of entrepreneurs in various sectors and various fields, is it becoming easier or even more tougher now for entrepreneurs to kind of, sustain themselves or, have that, to be on that successful path because of the competition that is going to be there? Everyone wants to now own a business.
But at a population of 1.3 billion,
you
have a market for
a
everybody, right? And to answer your question, I personally feel that this should be a compulsory subject even in colleges, where everybody has to go through this, everybody has to learn this as an art, because it is not necessary that you'll end up starting a company.
Everyone
but
has
even
that
being
streak,
in a company
yeah.
has to learn that attribute. In terms of answering your question, whether it is easier or tougher, I think we have just scratched the surface, and it has to go something like how Israel is doing it, or how Silicon Valley has done it, and we are just like just a percent of that, and we have to go a long way.
So if I had to ask three of you, what are the challenges you think the startups or the entrepreneurs really face when they are venturing out into this big world of starting up? Adhil, let's start with you.
I think we're betting on a future. So we're betting that tomorrow, right, the way consumers are going to behave is different from today. So that requires having that vision and sticking through that vision, though you face doubts at many times during the way. So for at BankBazaar, we've always felt our vision is financial services will be paperless and they will be presenceless. Now, obviously, that takes time. But to stick to that core vision and to be able to collaborate with the rest of the market such that they also see value in your vision, I think staying true to that vision is probably the hardest thing.
Any other challenge?
I'll just lean on a quote by Wayne Gretzky, most successful ice hockey player. So he said, the reason I'm successful, it's not because I go where the puck is, I go where the puck will be. And nobody else goes there. So that's, I think, the main thing about an entrepreneur. Can you identify or take a... have a conviction that this is where the world is headed, and I am going to be ready for it when this thing happens. And then you go down that path. And honestly, there would be hundreds of reasons why the puck will never reach there. But I think you have to have the conviction that you are taking that bet and stay true to it, that it'll someday get there.
Amit, certain conventional challenges that you can talk about that startups face, really?
To answer your question, we are just 7 years old, right? So when we see a contrast of how my father would speak about the challenges or the other entrepreneurs or the people we meet here, will be very different. Like, so to be very honest, we didn't find those challenges which my father would speak. But our challenge would be more like, how can you get growth quickly and how can, not even government, like how can things like FDI, things like infrastructure around more and more airports, more and more roads getting built can help. Like, sure. To give you an example, my third store was in Agartala of Lenskart, and to ship there, it used to take 7 days 4 years back, and today it takes for 24 hours, right? So, and that is just because there is an airport now. And that is the difference you can create by having an airport. And imagine we are 53 airports in the country right now. If it scales to 200 airports in another 4 or 5 years, there will be so much to and fro and so much conversions happening, so much transactions happening, which is something which is so important to overcome these challenges where anybody is thinking of a business to scale up.
You know, that's a challenge perhaps the next gen millennium won't have, because the infrastructure growth is also happening accordingly, and that's where these time lags and gestation periods, I think, will actually slow down. But when we interact a lot with startups, you know, they have issues of course, investment and finance has always been an issue with entrepreneurs and startups. But something that they really, really, are grappling with is talent retention. And that's one thing that, you know, I want to hear from you. How can they kind of look into that? Because I have heard these problems from, you know, people who've started up, who are into the business, let's say 3 years down the line. They have actually worked and they've been on ground. So how can they look at talent management and retention in their own firms? Because they don't have really those deep pockets, if I may say so.
Right. So from the technology perspective, right, I think the fight we face is, as a fintech startup, we compete with the best tech firms in the world. So every top tech firm or MNC you can think of has a development office in India, and essentially you're competing for the same talent. I find that if I was to pick one thing which would make a significant difference, it is the idea of impact, saying that, hey, when you work with us, when you work with a BankBazaar, that the work you do, right, impacts millions and millions of people in India trying to access financial product, and you're a big contributor in a country which is a locally grown startup versus being a small cog in a big, big multinational wheel. So I think if I was to pick one point which creates motivation and retention, right, it would be the point of impact, saying we're building technology that's making a difference not only to our friends and family, but to the entire country around us in terms of financial inclusion.
So I would say demand is more, supply is less, and it could be fulfilled in two ways. You know, one is, right now, if you see, there are more and more expats coming back to India. And the whole reason is that they know, as Adhil was mentioning, that the impact will be a lot higher in their whatever way they are working. And the other aspect is that there are people working in various companies where they still go to the office for the salary they get on first. But the idea is that at the inner desire is to create more and more impact. As a country, we are a hardworking country, right? And I feel that supply will solve this problem.
Well, I'm really glad you talked about impact, because I see entrepreneurs who are now mushrooming and starting their own businesses. They want to make that change. The change is the word that I would really focus on. And you know, it's the societal marketing that we're talking about here. Prashant, do you see that sort of vigor and that sort of a thought process that entrepreneurs are really now working towards?
Yes, and I would actually expand that.
Considering you're in one of that sector.
Yeah, and I would expand that a little bit to not just entrepreneurs, the entire generation Y or Z, whatever it is right now. I think people fundamentally are more excited by impact. They do not want, they're not looking for stability as the primary lever. They are looking for something exciting, some change they are bringing, some impact as a, and that's where the talent management also comes, that you have to have something that people are seeing. Things are moving at a very fast pace. They are learning at a fast pace. They are making decisions. They are participating in seeing what they are working, leading to some kind of results, and seeing it pretty directly. So, and for entrepreneurs, it's always about that, because I think one of your early questions was, is it about copying and pasting models from other countries? I think the low-hanging fruit, the obvious replication of models is long gone in the ecosystem. Things, the businesses that are coming are much more thought through, much more nuanced, and much more, in that sense, exciting, not only for the entrepreneur, but also the first set of believers that you have to have with you to build something.
So. And more around solving the problems of the country.
So Amit, if I had you to crystal gaze into the future, how do you see startups contributing to the future of India and impacting the economy?
India has so many problems and we need solutions, and startup is the only way out. Of course, with the collaboration of the necessity of infrastructure, which government will have to provide, because if our PM is speaking about eradicating poverty or giving home to everybody, all these are like problem statement, and the solution won't come by just making a program out of it, right? It has to come with people contributing to solve that. I feel overall, startup as a future, there will be, it will compound year on year, and it will only grow.
So on a closing note, if I had to ask you one advice you want to give to the young Turks who want to start out and start out big, what would that be? Adhil, you want to start?
So I think one advice I would give is one of the most important things you do, right, is deciding which investors you want to partner with. Partner with investors who believe in your long-term story. So there are many ways to go from here to where you need to be 10 years from now. For example, like I said, my vision is finance will be paperless. That's what BankBazaar believes in. We've always looked to partner with investors who have the ability to see the same future, because there'll be many questions which come in between, but you've got to stick to what you believe in, and the people around you, right, should believe it also. So I think that's one advice I would give. Pick your investor for someone who will support you in your vision.
Sure. Prashant?
I think it'll be about the first set of folks you bring with in your team. I think that's the core team you would have. It has to be a bunch of crazy people who are not looking for optimization, but looking for the spike. And for whatever reason, they have to be fully aligned with whatever you are planning to do. And because if that is not in place, whatever you do will not...
That's the foundation, I guess.
It's the core.
Amit, yeah.
So we are still very young to give advices, but if we look back our journey...
You've already been called a veteran, now you need to give advices.
So if you just look back our journey, I think what we have learned is focus is very important. Don't ride on multiple boats. If you have focus to solve a problem, I think you'll figure out something or the other to put your brains into it.
So great partnership, a great team, and immense focus is what we actually take back from this panel. And I would like to open the floor to the audience. If there are any questions, we'll be only able to take one. I think there is one hand there. Can you please introduce yourself and give your question?
Hi, my name is Karanveer Mundre, and one of the companies I run is a communications and PR company called Atharva Marcom. And I wanted to know from the panel, since also there is Times Now sitting here, which is the most efficient communication method that you have used to reach out to your customers? Has it been digital? Has it been print? How have you reached out? Because these are new ideas. So how did you get your new idea to be understood by people? What was your communication and PR media strategy?
Anyone would like to answer that?
Oh, so for us, what we have realized is that when you're in consumer masses, the best thing which works is do all of them, and trends will continue to change. Today, people converse on Instagram. It might be different tomorrow. It had been different yesterday. So I think we'll have to keep on changing. But keeping a 360 approach gives the best results, at least from our learning.
I think I just would like to add, because we at Times Group have the liberty of all mediums and, you know, channels that we can work on, whether it's digital, whether it's print, whether it's TV. It really boils down to who you want to reach to and how you want to do that. And you can use any medium. Unless and until it doesn't reach them, it's not effective. So I think it really boils down to what is the end objective of the activity that you're planning to do, in our case at least. Well, on that note, I think we'd had a very invigorating panel on startups and entrepreneurship. And I think this vigor and role models that you talked about are truly going to inspire not only the next generation, but I think the generation that has gone by to start over, you know, all over again. So thank you so much for being on this esteemed panel at the FICCI AGM. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Smriti. I think you did a very wonderful job. And we're very proud of our startups, all three of you. We wish you to be a unicorn, serve 7.2 billion people, go beyond India, be global. We wish you all the best. With this, we'd like to close the session. Thank you. I'll go to the left.